Welcome to the another video of the basic electrical engineering. This is the continuity of the first video of the induction motor. So induction motor, the stator part we have discussed, and also we have analyzed that if a three phase supply is given to the induction motor and the position of R, Y and B phase is like this, then there is a north pole and south pole virtual is being created where the flux is move from the north to south, and this north pole changes its position. This is at time T0, north pole is here, and the north pole is changing its position gradually at time T1 when it is making 90 degree electrical. The north pole is also mechanically displaced from his present position of 0 degree to a 90 degree position, and like that this is making a rotation. The north pole is changing its position and making a complete circle. Instead of saying all those things, we are saying that when we give a three phase supply, it will create a revolving flux phi s, which is also called the synchronous flux, which rotate in the clockwise at a speed of 120 f by p in revolution per minute, or we can say ns is revolution per second, that is 2f by p. If the frequency of the supply is fixed, so this speed of the flux, revolving flux, will also be fixed. And then we are going to do the analysis that if this is a revolving flux, how does it will induce a current in the rotor winding. So to understand it, let us have another figure. Let us suppose that you have got a north pole over here, and this north pole, another is a south pole over here, where the flux lines of force are traveling in this direction. And then we assume that we have a conductor over here. This magnet, north and south pole, it is actually moving, changing its position from this positive x-axis, and it's changing its position and in such a way and making the complete revolution of it. It's changing its position and making a circle, making a complete circle, and the speed is given by ns is given by 2f by p, or ns is equal to 120 f by p in revolution per minute or revolution per second. Now if it is drifted in the lower direction or in the clockwise direction, and imagine that you are sitting on the magnet. If you are sitting on the magnet, the conductor is seen to be rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. Why we are doing it? Because we are going to use the Fleming right hand rule. So from the Fleming right hand rule, the three finger of the right hand, you have to make it perpendicular to each other. Doing it perpendicular, and the conductor is assumed, it seems to be moving in the upward direction because you are sitting on a magnet. So the motion is given by the thumb. So point your thumb to the upward direction. Take your right hand first. Point your thumb in the upward direction. Your index finger is the direction of lines of force in straight towards the left hand side of the screen. If thumb is upward, index finger is left hand side of the screen. Your middle finger, so here will be your index finger. The middle finger will be coming out of the screen. So if coming out of the screen is given by a dot. Again, so if it's a magnet is rotated, virtual magnet is being, suppose there is a virtual magnet north and south pole, and this magnet is being rotated in the anti-clockwise, sorry, in the clockwise, and you assume yourself that you are sitting on the magnet, then you will feel like that conductor, if even though it is static, since the magnet is rotating in clockwise, this conductor is rotating in the anti-clockwise at the same speed. That is ns, it is rotating in anti-clockwise speed. So if you use a Fleming's right hand thumb rule, your thumb is pointing upward, your index finger is pointing towards the left hand side of the screen, and your middle finger is coming out of the screen, that is given by dot. Similarly, now if there would have been a conductor over here, if there would have been a conductor over here, now this south pole, this north pole, when it will come down to this one, at this particular moment of time, here the conductor seems to be moving in the opposite direction. Why? If this north pole is moving in the clockwise, in the downward, the south pole is also going clockwise in the upward. If south pole, somebody is sitting and it is going upward, and this conductor is here, so he will see the conductor is rotating in the, this conductor is going downward direction. Using the right hand thumb rule, your index finger is still in the left hand side, but the thumb is in the downward. If the thumb is downward and the index finger is in the left hand side, here you will get a cross. So at the same instant, if these two conductors are there, one in the right hand side and one on the left hand side, you will find that one conductor will have a dot, another conductor will have a cross. Now what I will do is that I will try to give him a cover, like through a this conductor will be placed inside an iron core, and here also it will be placed inside an iron core. Now, if these are placed inside an iron core, let me erase this part. So if this is placed inside iron core over here, and similarly we can create another slots over here so that we can place the conductors. For the simplicity, we are not making a jumble of different number of slots, we are just keeping minimum number of slots just for the understanding. So like that we can have different these slots, we can have different conductors over here. At a particular moment of time, this conductor 1 and 2 is having, they are having a like dot and cross, as mentioned, is being shown. Now from this, what we understand is that this part is called the rotor of the induction motor. Now this rotor of the induction motor is not mechanically touched with the stator. There is an air gap between the rotor and the stator part. Now we are assuming that there is a virtual north pole is there on the upper cover of it, like because when the three phase supply is given to the stator, it creates a virtual north pole and south pole on the stator, and these north pole and south pole are rotating in the clockwise. And if we are assuming that we are sitting in the north pole, then we feel like this conductor is rotating in the anti-clockwise. At what speed this conductor is rotating, or at what speed the entire thing is rotating? This entire thing is rotating at a speed of N, let us write in capital letter, NS, that is synchronous speed, 120 F by P, revolution per minute. Now, because of this rotation, because of the thinking that this is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction, there is a relative motion between the flux and the conductor. So, in either case, whether the conductor is static and the flux is rotating, or the flux is static, the conductor is rotating, there is a EMF is induced in the conductor. Since the EMF is induced in the conductor, the current direction is shown with the help of Fleming's right hand thumb rule. So now we understand that because if there is a flux there, and this flux, if it is rotating, it can induce an EMF in the rotor. And the EMF induced in the rotor will be such that it will try to oppose the cause which is producing it. So what is the cause? The cause is the relative motion between the flux and the rotor. The cause is the flux is rotating here, or if you are sitting on the magnet, the rotor is rotating in the anti-clockwise at the speed. Now that is the cause. So the EMF which is induced in the rotor, it will try to decrease the relative motion between the flux and the rotor. As you can see that rotor is drawn in the same figure, the flux is revolving in the clockwise direction, and when you are sitting on the flux, it seems that the conductor is rotating in the anti-clockwise. And through that we get a picture that here there will be a, on the right hand side, what with the picture we get a dot on the right hand side and cross at the left hand side. So we keep on putting a dot here at the dots over here, and at this particular time here there is a cross when the flux is at this position. Gradually when the flux is changing its position, obviously this thing will change. So at this particular time when the flux is here or the north pole is here, we are getting a dot on the side and the cross at this point. So when you say that all the dots are here, so at this we can jumble up, this is a all dot, and we use a Fleming's right hand thumb rule to know the direction of flux. We find that it is like flux is making an anti-clockwise direction, and if this is a cross, this is a flux is making a clockwise direction of motion. Clockwise direction, flux is rotating. That means if you put your thumb out of the screen, the thumb is, put your thumb inside the screen. Cross means inside the screen, the thumb is making a clockwise revolution. If you put your thumb out of the screen, the thumb is making an anti-clockwise revolution, and all the flux is coming from top to bottom. So this is a body made up of iron core. So all the flux is coming from top to bottom. So we can assume that from the, this is an iron core now. So if you have an iron core and all the flux is moving in this side, so where the flux is going out is the north pole. Where the flux is coming in will be the south pole. So this side will be the south and this side will be the north. So let us say S2 and N2 denoting the south and north pole of the rotor part. So let me erase these portions just to keep it the north and south both here. So at the instant when you have a N1 and S1 over here on the stator, at that instant you have S2 and N2 created at the rotor side. So this flux is now rotating at the speed of 120 F by P, and this flux you cannot stop because this flux is depending on the supply frequency. As long as the supply frequency is there, supply current is there, magnitude voltage is there, so there will be a magnitude of flux, and as long as this input voltage is changing, so this flux is going to rotate. Now you can see that if this north and south pole is there, if it is trying to rotate here, it will try to repel this north pole, and this south pole is getting tried to attract. S2 is attracted with N1, and if N1 is rotating here, this N1 is going to repel N2, and N2 is getting attracted with S1. Like that, this there will be a repulsion between N1 and N2, and if this is rotating at synchronous speed, this rotor will try to rotate but cannot rotate at synchronous speed. Try to rotate means it will try to rotate at the synchronous speed, that is called the flux which is trying to rotate at synchronous speed. Let me elaborate a little bit of. So the flux of the stator is given as, the flux of the stator is given as psi r, and because of the flux of the stator, the effect of it, there is a flux of the rotor also there, and that is also called psi r, psi s and psi r. The relative speed between psi s and psi r will always be fixed. That means if psi s is rotating at a speed of, let us say, 1500 rpm, psi r is also rotating at 1500 rpm. Now what happened? Here psi s is created by the stator. Stator who himself is not rotating. It is creating a flux psi s that is rotating at 1500 rpm. Now psi r, which is supposed to rotate at 1500 rpm, and it is created by a rotor. Now, when rotor itself is rotating at certain speed, rotor is running at, let us assume that rotor is running at a speed of 1440 RPM. Now, if rotor is running at 1440 RPM, his flux should rotate at 60 RPM. Or if you sit in a rotor, you will assume, you will feel like your flux is running at a 60 RPM. And if you sit on the rotor stator part, if you sit on the ground and you can see that both stator flux is running at 1500 and rotor flux is running at 1500. But if you sit on the rotor, you will find that rotor flux is running at 60 RPM. This is all our relative speed. Why I am saying that the phi s and phi r, the relative speed is fixed, because if the relative speed is not fixed, so they may exceed each other or they may cross each other. There is no crossing between them. N1 will remain in that direction. N1 and N2 will always be then a 90 degree as long as there is a no change in the loading effect. If the loading effect is there, there will be a little bit of change, drift in the direction of N1 and N2. Instead of 90 degree, it will be 90 degree plus some angle. But the speed of N1 and N2 will remain be fixed, and there will be remain fixed at the same synchronous speed 1500. Yes, there may be an angular change between N1 and N2. That is possible. So what we understand from here is that we need not to explain the entire thing for the working of the induction motor. Rather, we can simplify our explanation by saying that because of the revolving flux, it induces EMF in the rotor. If it induces EMF in the rotor in such a way, the rotor start revolve in the same direction of the flux, so that the relative speed between the flux and the rotor will be minimum or will be zero. But as soon as the rotor speed is equal to the stator flux, the relative speed is zero and there is no torque. To explain it, we can write that when we give a three-phase supply, it leads to the current, and that current leads to the flux, the mutual flux, that current lead to the mutual flux phi m. This mutual flux linked with this primary coil induces a EMF E1, and also linked with the secondary, here the secondary is the rotor E2. This phi m depend, the speed of the phi m depend on the frequency of the input voltage and the current. So output induced EMF E1 and E2, its induced EMF is also depending on the flux. So E1 is given as number of turns of the stator d phi m by dt. Similarly, E2 is given as number of turns of the rotor d phi m by dt. The phi m, this E1 induced EMF in the E1 will not be altered, because phi m is phi m sin omega t. The frequency of phi m will remain fixed for E1, because rate of change of phi m with respect to dt will not be going to change, because it depends on the supply. Whereas the EMF E2 induced because of this phi m, E2, N2 d phi m by dt, this phi m speed with respect to dt is going to affect. Because EMF induced in the rotor seems to the rotor as if E2 is equal to N2 d phi m by dt. This time at which it is, the flux is linked, is going to be affected in E2. That is N2 into d phi m, this time will not be the same as the time of E1, because the flux which is linking with the rotor, even though the stator flux is running at 1500, Now, if the rotor will start rotating, the relative speed will decrease. Then this time will not be the same, that means this time will be t dash. Or we can say, since the time is the inverse of the frequency, we can multiply the frequency term with phi m and we can find the value. So all this detailed analysis we will do later. And so far what we have understood is that the rotating flux induces the EMF in the rotor circuit, and because of this induced EMF, the rotor start rotating in the direction of the flux. We have seen by creating a virtual north and south pole in the rotor. Also, we are going to observe the same thing by explaining that with the help of Lenz's law, that it will try to cause, or it will try to have an effect which will oppose the cause which is producing it. So the cause is the relative motion between the flux and the rotor. So obviously rotor will rotate in such a way so that the relative motion will decrease. And if the relative motion will decrease, the torque in the rotor will be lesser and lesser. We will discuss about the torque of the rotor in the next video.